Hello. Of all the endless mysteries and disagreements about the Giza Pyramids or any other of the ancient cyclopean sites we can find around the world, one topic most or nearly everyone with an opinion can agree with, it's that they were not easy to make. Built before or after the flood by one global or many local cultures with advanced lost or basic present technology, polished stone or geopolymer, there is hardly any doubt that building these massive walls was hard. So hard, it's even hard to grasp. It was hard enough to be civilization ending. Take the geopolymer hypothesis. The idea that some of the most elegant stone puzzles we can see around the world in ancient ruins assembled into magnificent walls were not built by polishing hard stone blocks with abrasive sand, but with a man-made cement that can emulate rock once it's dried up. This idea is hastily discarded by many academics, but that's in part why it's so interesting. For the Orthodox police inside universities, the geopolymer hypothesis is an absolute no-no. They claim it's impossible to make stone-like blocks out of a meshy mixture of soft materials, just because they themselves don't know how to. But at the same time, the opposite field, the proponents of lost civilizations with magical technology, wildly overestimate what could have been accomplished with this cement or cast stone. In the meantime, there are two very interesting works advancing the geopolymer hypothesis that are worth detailing. One is being done by the Natron Theory. The link is in the description. A very sharp guy that is currently conducting experiments with materials readily available for the ancient Egyptians and promising to replicate some of the odd shapes of stones we can see in sites like the Menkaure Temple. The Natron Theory works by mixing several salts and wood ash under large amounts of heat to obtain a dark gray paste that can then be molded into shape, left to dry and harden in a way it will resemble some dark igneous rock or basalt. This idea, possible in theory, seems harder to replicate for materials like pink granite and would be useful for a small part of the Egyptian pyramids, as those are made of mostly softer sandstone. However remote, the Natron Theory could be an explanation to some persistent mysteries of stone around the Giza Plateau. Another case of experiments that might work is the work done by Helmut Tribusch on the Inca red clay hypothesis, following a clue left back in the 16th century by the Spanish, writing down that the Inca would use a red paste, not to make cement, not to cast a stone, but to create a powerful acid that could dissolve the stones under pressure. This other idea is not only possible, as Helmut showed, it makes sense with what we can see today in Cusco. The red clay acid would work by placing two half-finished stones together and with the acid in the middle. Then the pressure done by the top stone would activate the acid that would warm up in reaction with the stone, further increasing the effect, up to dissolving the stone's poorly fitted surfaces, enabling both the fantastic precision shapes and the vitreous finishing we cannot otherwise explain. In opposition to these two ideas, the official explanation is that no sort of chemical approach nor even metallurgy was used in cyclopean sites, and that all the work in all those crazy bent stones was made just by slowly polishing rock with sand. This low-tech method of abrasion is probably the solution for the majority of stones, even those with odd shapes. But it reminds us that the work of polishing precision shapes out of rock is as cumbersome as it sounds, including having to carry sand from hundreds of kilometers away, because the sand in the desert is not appropriate for the task. For curiosity, note that to this day, the desert country of Saudi Arabia is a major importer of sand. Despite it seeming like someone is selling ice to the Eskimos over there, it goes as showing the extent of work involved in building whatever, even today. Going back to the past, both these alternative options or ideas, the natron or the red clay, are interesting and are worth exploring, even if shown impossible, as they would at least explain away some of the most awe-inspiring stones, either by explaining how they were done or by demonstrating that there was no easy way to have done it, with the latter being already achieved, since both the ideas are super costly. See, either the natron theory or the red clay options require outrageous amounts of work and energy to prepare. It's not an easy fix in any way. People instinctively assume that the geopolymer hypothesis would allow the ancients to build massive stuff with relative ease, just by mixing ready-made pastes bought at the Home Depot. But they are wrong. There was no Home Depot back then, and even if there was, the work needed to stock it would be just about the same. Even today, making cement is expensive. Cement factories are voracious consumers of fuel, and the product is hard to transport and to manipulate. Those funny mixer trucks we see around construction sites are not only cute, they are needed. Likewise, importing sand into the Saudi desert, it's not an eccentricity. Those are the sort of complicated tasks needed to make buildings with cement work. And that is to say nothing of the massive factories where the powder itself is generated. For the ancient Egyptians to achieve a similar result, it would require a similar effort. And they did build the pyramids. Not saying the Egyptians had cement. I don't know if they had it. And for this matter, it does not make any difference. What I'm saying is that the amount of work and energy needed to build a pyramid out of polished stone blocks or geopolymer is massive, either way. And it's so hard and exhausting it gets to be civilization ending. Note this, the pyramids seem to have been built backwards, starting with the best and bigger ones, absolute world wonders, and moving on to build sad piles of sand later on. This happened not because the Egyptians got dumb and forgot how to pile up rocks, but because they got poor as a result of doing the really big pyramids beforehand. If we look at the carbon dating for the organic material in a pyramid, we see that each pyramid consumes wood from at least 300 years before the completion. This might mean a lot of things, like the pyramids took longer to build or that they were not built for just one king. But it also means that the pyramids exhausted the natural resources accumulated over centuries. It doesn't matter if you believe the pyramids existed for thousands of years before and the pharaohs only repurposed them, or that they are basic tombs hiding the bodies. In every case, the work done by the dynastic Egyptians 4,000 years ago was over the top. It was impossible to support and led to a steep decline in the living standards of the population. The pyramids are not unlike any other public infrastructure plans, such as the high-speed railway in California, in the sense that they are so damn expensive, wasteful, and even corrupt that, for the population, the cheaper option was if they were never built. Meaning, it's really bad that billions are being spent into making a few hundred meters of useless railway in LA. But it would be even worse if trillions were actually wasted completing the whole length of the thing. And we know the pyramids were built to completion. Thus, the Egyptians paid the full price of that madness. Even with geopolymer, building the pyramid or a high-speed rail network is civilization ending. It is a project that would consume so much of the working people's savings just to aggrandize the ego of the ruling elite that the outcome is assured misery. Any society that can take away from the population such large amounts of resources to concentrate it all in the vanity projects of the elite is doomed. Ironically, it's the good times that precipitate the doom, or at least open up the possibility for fatal mistakes being made by the people in power. Meaning, if the ancient Egyptians were poor and barely scraping by, as most other cultures in that era, they would not commit to building anything so magnificent as the pyramids. But the Nile is a civilization cheat code. It allowed for unparalleled wealth, and all that wealth was then exhausted by the pyramids. It does not matter how they were done, geopolymer or not, nor when it was done, or even for what purpose. The size and scope of the pyramids alone is civilization ending. Either polishing granite into oblivion or burning entire forests to make geopolymer, the outcome would be about the same, a sad pile of sand, such as the pyramid of Unas. Unas, the later pharaoh with the sand pile, would not be more modest nor reasonable than his predecessors. The reason Unas got a shabby dune whilst his grand-grandpa Khufu got the best building ever made is just because he was damn broke. It's the nature of governments to take all they can grab and waste it as fast as they grab it. If one official is ever limited, it's never in their intentions, but always in their reach. If we let them, they would build pyramids anyway. Geopolymer or not, it's up to us to say no. Otherwise, they will end up civilization, as did the megalithic builders. That's it for today. Please leave a like to appease the YouTube overlords. I'll see you soon.